Nervous tissue is usually considered the fourth of the basic tissues of histology. Today, we're going to cover the basic structure of the nervous system and the functions of neurons and glia. I'm Dr. Catherine Moore, the histology wizard. So first, let's briefly review the function of the nervous system. Now we know the essential function of the nervous system is to collect information from the body and our surrounding environment, to integrate that information and then respond in some way, either through directing behavior or creating concepts and memories. At the same time, the nervous system manages functions such as breathing, moving food through our digestive system, or even maintaining posture. Now, to accomplish all these tasks, the nervous system has two major classes of cells. First, neurons, which are the functional and structural unit of the nervous system. These cells are electrically excitable and they generate action potentials. And they're linked together into circuits which can have a few or hundreds or thousands of connections. Generally speaking, the more complex the task, the more circuits and more connections are needed. Second, there are different glial cells which provide essential support for neurons, among other tasks. Now we know that the nervous system is the most complex system in the body, with roughly 100 billion neurons and even more glial cells. In terms of organization, we can divide the nervous system anatomically into the central nervous system, or CNS, which consists of the brain and the spinal cord. And the CNS also includes the ears and the eyes, which I haven't shown here. And the peripheral nervous system, which receives sensory information from the outside world and conditions in the body, in addition to transmitting signals to effectors in our muscles and glands. Now, in addition, the nervous system has functional divisions. Somatic or voluntary component, which usually has central elements and output controlled by thinking, and the autonomic nervous system, which has both central and peripheral elements, and they control things such as gut activity. Subdivisions of the autonomic nervous system include the parasympathetic and sympathetic divisions and the enteric nervous system. Now today, however, we're going to just focus on the neuronal structures, their basic structure, function, and some histology. And we'll begin with neurons. And I'll first describe the basic structure and types of neurons, and then I'll go into a little more detail on neuronal structure. So we know that neurons need to be able to receive, process, and send relay signals. In this cartoon, which is a really basic generic neuron, we see the cell body, or the perikaryon, the axon, or nerve fiber, and dendrites. And neurons also contain numerous specialized membrane structures or regions called synapses that receive and transfer signals from neuron to neuron or neuron to effector cell. So we know that neurons are polarized cells, and they have signals that arrive at the dendrites, move to the cell bodies, and then to the axon to be transmitted to other cells. So this is our generic cartoon, and here you can see a trace of a Purkinje cell of the cerebellum. Its dendrites are much more elaborate than the basic image I showed you, but the components are essentially the same. And here, for comparison, I'm showing you the relative size of this neuron as compared to a typical white blood cell, the lymphocyte. Now, neurons can have different forms, and these differences reflect different functions. Neurons can be classified based on the overall shape of the cell body, with the most common being the granular versus the pyramidal shape. The length of the axon can also vary. Again, this reflects function. Neurons with long axons are usually projection neurons that have glutamate as a neurotransmitter, and they are excitatory. While interneurons are local axons, they're usually GABAergic, and they're inhibitory. The complexity of the dendritic arbor can also vary from simple to very branched and elaborate. And again, this reflects different functions. Histologically speaking, it's pretty hard to actually visualize neurons using our basic stains. Here is a hematoxylin and eosin stained, or H&E stained image from the cortex, and you can really only see the cell bodies of the neurons here in pale purple. Often we'll use Nissl stain. This is a stain used in nervous tissue, a special stain that binds to rough endoplasmic reticulum and DNA and RNA. But again, we're mostly looking at the cell body here, as you can see by the arrows. Another special stain that you'll see in lab is the Golgi stain. So this is a silver stain. This stain starts a silver chromate reaction
in neurons that fills the neurons entirely, so you can see the axon, the dendrites, and the cell body. The cool part about the Golgi stain is that for some reason it fills neurons randomly, so this makes imaging easier. In today's neuroscience laboratories, these stains are still used, but more commonly researchers will use antibodies to specific proteins or neurotransmitters, or GFP tracers, to visualize neurons.
Let's step back to our generic neuron and dive a little bit deeper into each component, and we'll start with the cell body. Here we have both a cartoon and a Nissl-stained image showing the cell body. The cell body can range from very small, let's say for a granule cell of CNS, to 100 microns in a larger neuron, but in general, the bulk of the neuron mass isn't found in the cell body. The nucleus of a neuron contains euchromatin and generally stains rather pale with a prominent nucleolus. Now, since most of the components of the axons and dendrites are produced in the cell body and shipped out, the cell body is packed with rough endoplasmic reticulum, active Golgi, and lots of Nissl substance or bodies. And you can see in the Nissl stained image on the right that really only the cell body is staining darkly. Another important component of the cell body are neurofilaments. These are specific intermediate filaments that are produced in the cell body, but then they extend into axons and dendrites where they provide structural support. Improper assembly or overproduction in motor neurons of these intermediate filaments can result in loss of these filaments, and that can result in diseases such as amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, or ALS. Now, the axon or nerve fiber connects the cell body to the terminal synapse and to the signaling target of the neuron. These are usually unbranched, but they might have a few collateral branches. And axons are specialized to conduct an action potential or electrical signal toward that synaptic terminal. And this is very, very rapid communication. Axons can be short or very long, and that depends again on where the signal needs to go. So a neuron that needs to send signals to the lower spinal cord might be up to 1 meter long. And most neurons have only one axon, although there are exceptions. Larger diameter axons are myelinated by glial cells. You can think of this as a sort of insulation that increases the speed of the conduction of action potential. The axoplasm, or cytoplasm of the axon, has tons of microtubules and neurofilaments, and all are produced in the cell body. So now there has to be machinery to distribute these components, and these depend upon microtubules which serve as guides and motors that move things. Anterior grade transport takes things from the cell body in the direction of the action potential, while retrograde transport moves things in the opposite direction. Now, one interesting question for many years was whether there was actually protein synthesis in the axon, and we now know that this is true, but it appears to be mostly associated with injury or neurodegeneration. The last major component is the dendrite, and here I'm showing a pyramidal neuron of the hippocampus expressing GFP. And you can note the triangular cell body and the extensive dendritic tree. Now, the job of dendrites is to receive and integrate inputs and generate a synaptic current. And dendrites can be highly branched. And again, the shape of the dendrite arbor reflects its function. Many dendrites in the cortex or cerebellum also have small mushroom-shaped projections called spines. And these are specialized to receive input. These structures are highly dynamic, they can change shape and number, and they're implicated in learning and memory. Now, I've alluded to the structure known as the synapse, which is that specialized signaling contact between the axon terminal and its target. And there are multiple synaptic targets. Less commonly, we have the target of the cell body or even the axon, but more commonly, we have axodendritic synapses. So synapses that either target the spine or the dendrite itself. Now, the general structure is shown here, a presynaptic area or projection, and then there's a postsynaptic area or density, and the space between them is called the synaptic cleft. And signaling generally takes place via the release of chemical messengers into that cleft. They're received by receptors on the target cell. And this is important because this arrangement keeps the signal headed in one direction only. So let's see how that works in a generic synapse. Here in a very highly simplified cartoon, we have the presynaptic terminal, the synaptic cleft, and the postsynaptic terminal or density. And when the action potential reaches the axon terminal, calcium channels on that neuron will open, causing calcium to enter the terminal. That calcium then causes vesicles in the terminal to release neurotransmitter. And that neurotransmitter now is going to diffuse across the synaptic cleft, bind to neurotransmitter receptors on the postsynaptic membrane. Now these are ligand-gated channels, and when they open, this triggers a signal in the postsynaptic neuron or other target cell. Now interestingly, synapse formation isn't a static process. We know that neurons will form multiple synapses to maximize available connections. So as an organism matures, or as a brain matures, or a brain region matures, some synapses are used more frequently, and these connections are consequently strengthened. Other synapses are not used as often, and so these connections are weakened and eventually eliminated. And we call this synaptic pruning, and it can actually take a long time, and different parts of the brain will have variation in the timing and the extent of their pruning. Synaptic pruning is really critical. It's critical in development to reinforce learning and behavior, but it's also central to how we learn as adults as well. And glial cells are known to be important for this process. So of course there can be problems with synaptic pruning and with maturation of synapses, and these can lead to diseases such as Rett syndrome, which has profound effects on multiple systems, as you might expect. Children with Rett syndrome tend to have problems in learning, in speech, mood, movement, breathing, even chewing and swallowing and digestion. All right, well, let's move on and look at some glial cells. We can divide our glial cell types into both central nervous system and peripheral nervous system types, as well as macro and microglia. Now, in the mature CNS, there are two major macroglia, astrocytes and oligodendrocytes, and there are also microglia. In the PNS, the major glial type is the Schwann cell. And now we're going to dive a bit deeper and talk about a few glial cell types and some of their functions. First, we have the astrocyte, which is the most numerous glial cell in the CNS, and it's a star-shaped cell, which you can see here in this silver stain. It contains glial fibrillary acidic protein, or GFAP, and that marks an intermediate filament protein, specifically in astrocytes. These cells have a lot of functions. They ensheath synapses, they take up potassium neurotransmitters, they produce growth factors, they produce neuroactive factors, and a lot of these factors are actually being investigated for use in treatment of Parkinson's and Alzheimer's disease. Astrocytes also make end feet on capillaries, and they help transfer molecules from the blood to neurons. Once thought to be a very lowly support cell, we know now that astrocytes constitute a huge network that influences neuronal signaling and that they also play a large role in neurodegeneration. Next up is the oligodendrocyte. These are small round cells and they maintain CNS neurons, they promote their survival, and they also myelinate CNS axons. Each oligodendrocyte can form and maintain the myelin sheath that wraps like a helix around axons. And in the CNS, one oligodendrocyte can myelinate many, many axons. And so myelin, again, is a lot like insulation on a wire, and the structure of the myelination allows rapid saltatory conduction of an action potential. Now this schematic shown here shows a myelinated CNS fiber in purple with the plasma membrane of the myelinating glial cell depicted in green. And this electron micrograph shows myelinated axons that are densely packed within white matter. Now in this case, we're looking at a mouse optic nerve. And you can see that the myelin sheaths of neighboring fibers often directly touch. In the peripheral nervous system, we have our Schwann cells. And these are found in sensory and autonomic ganglia, where they surround neurons. They're also sometimes called capsule or satellite cells. In general, they function similar to astrocytes in these ganglia. Now, in all peripheral nerves, Schwann cells in sheath axons and in larger axons, they function just like oligodendrocytes to myelinate these axons. But interestingly, they only myelinate one segment of one axon. So here you can see an H&E stained image of a peripheral nerve with the Schwann cell nuclei. Finally, we have the microglia. These cells are derived from precursors in the yolk sac that enter early into the brain and persist for decades. These multi-talented cells can act in immune responses, They can function like macrophages. They present antigens, they release cytokines, they engulf debris, and they are critical for neuronal pruning. These professional surveyors of the CNS also regulate neuronal proliferation, differentiation, and synapse elimination. And more recently, these cells have been shown to be contributors to many degenerative diseases, including glaucoma. Now with microglia, that's a wrap on our review of cells of the nervous system. Be sure to check out, like, and comment on my other videos. Suggestions and topics always welcome. Thanks for stopping by.